Hello, I'm Rirkrit Tiravanija, and I'm an artist. I don't even know what I do really. Do nothing.
And my name's Elizabeth Peyton, and I'm an artist.
From David Zwirner, this is Dialogues, a podcast about artists and the way they think.
I always had a feeling about that when I was in school, about living, like using it, the limitation, as a positive thing. And that's a big reason why I was making small pictures, because I always felt like I could just put that work in a suitcase and take it with me wherever, you know, and it would be easier for people to take care of it.
Mm.
And it could kind of go in a stealthy way out into the world.
Right. My class is about like not doing anything.
Yeah.
Right? But it's, again, it's not about not doing anything. It's about like rethinking what it is that one does, you know? And I mean, I see the role of the artist in society as like the counterposition from the rest of the other positions, right? I'm going to not do when everyone's doing.
I'm Lucas Werner, and every episode features a conversation. We're taking artists, writers, philosophers, designers, and musicians and putting them in conversation with each other to explore what it means to make things today. This week's pairing, the artists Rirkrit Tiravanija and Elizabeth Peyton. In this last episode of the season, we're hosting two artists who are old friends, both legends in their own right, and were also married for a number of years in the 1990s. Rirkrit, who will have his first show with the gallery in Hong Kong later this year, is known for art that brings people together. Whether he's cooking curry for his audience or working with his students at Columbia, he embraces art that has a living, social dimension. And Elizabeth is one of our great humanist painters, someone who prizes and practices freedom, perhaps above anything else. She's known for her intimate paintings of people, whether they're famous and long dead, or friends who are close to her in life. Both Rirkrit and Elizabeth emerged in the New York art world of the 90s, in the orbit of legendary gallerist Gavin Brown, and over the years they've built a sort of ersatz artist family all their own.
So maybe by way of this conversation is making me think, one way of getting into the conversation is to actually go back in time a little bit, or a lot. And
Depends how you look at things.
It's indeed. It depends how you look at things. But it feels like both your moment when that there's a moment that people are really looking back at the 90s.
Mm-hmm.
I'd be very interested to hear what was where were people spending their time just kind of building out that world of the 90s, being an artist at that time in New York, what that felt like.
Well, we weren't aware it was the 90s.
Exactly.
First of all. But I don't know what comes to, I was thinking on the way up here was how we were kind of waiting to hang out with people in a way. But we were like going to loads of openings.
You know? What do you mean waiting to hang out with people? In what sense?
Well, I remember this is like maybe a couple years into the story, but Gavin had finally got his gallery and Piat had made a dance floor and you made a bar. And then you went away. But, you know, Gavin and I were like literally just waiting there for people to come hang out because we thought it'd be so great to have a place where artists hung out.
Right.
Which
so
then,
this is like Broom Street.
Yeah. But before that,
right.
We were hanging out at the Vietnamese restaurant.
Mm. That's where we had our wedding dinner.
Truck. Oh, yeah. And Rirkrit was putting on shows in the back of the art handling truck that he worked in.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like what kind of, what do you mean? Temporary shows or what, when the
yeah.
truck, when the
Ricky
truck was.
Ricky Albende had a show there.
And you would take it to Soho.
We would drive it
go
around
to collector's
and
houses.
Park it and just open it up and people would go in and look at the show. It's interesting because it was really like, it seemed, okay, first it feels smaller. Everything feels like much. The circle seemed smaller in the sense that we seem to know most people. And
yeah.
I'm sure everybody has that at
perception,
their
right?
Also, the money had left
yeah.
in
post-crash.
That moment.
Yeah.
And so people, you know, I think every every generation that comes to that world probably is doing a level of, let's have a show in the storage space, let's have a show in this parking garage. But that's really where everything was happening.
Yeah.
It felt like.
No, and there was, like, you know, people like Eric Oppenheim.
Yeah, my first show in the bathroom of the Novecento.
Well,
on
your first...
West Broadway. Oh, no, it wasn't my first show.
No, you've had shows.
No,
before,
I had a proper show.
But that was
that.
Like, a, but yeah. It was... So that was that show.
Yeah.
And then Gavin did a lot of little shows
office
in
space.
Different spaces.
Spaces, exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, he did one on Madison Avenue just, you know, because people were renting like little cubby holes, so they would have an address on Madison Avenue. So this idea of like, no, it used to be like, you know, things would, if you had a business, you had to be on Madison, right? So he went and got a little office space and did a show. And yeah, I mean, it's interesting because at that time it was really kind of, I mean, I think it's a lot of this idea of like self-organized thing, mm-hmm. right? And it was really more about energy.
Mm. I think it was also in keeping with what we were studying, or definitely what, you know, in our postmodern classes in school, about, you know, going outside of the institutions.
Mm.
And so maybe the financial situation and what we were studying also was all going together to, you know, be that we could frame different places as our places to work.
And when you say going out of institutions, you mean sort of like breaking out of the museum, typical museum space?
Well,
or
I wouldn't have even had access to that. Yeah. But, yeah, or not necessarily thinking a gallery is the...
space that where art needs to be shown.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, not being dependent on
being
that.
More direct. Just,
I mean, you know, because it seemed like there were like galleries with artists that were... I mean, you know, there were people, I mean, there, it's all in time, but I guess,
yeah.
you know, you could see that there's a whole kind of the establishment, and then there were like the other people.
And what did the establishment, because, I mean, coming out of the 80s, so you had all those 80s painters who I guess were
Yeah, we
dominant,
would go visit
right?
all those galleries, like Mary Boone, Leo Castelli.
Yeah.
Sonnabend. Sonnabend.
Paula.
Yeah.
Paula. Cooper. No, those, I mean, you know. I mean, when I landed, right, I mean, East Village scene was starting to happen. So
yeah.
there was still, like, even graffiti,
mm.
you know, Gracie
oh,
Mansion,
yeah.
and then Pat Hearn opened, like, around the corner from 7th Street.
Mm-hmm.
And then Colin had a space also on 6th Street, right?
Mm.
And
oh,
so,
yeah.
you know, so, and there were, like, all these, so there was, like, Soho galleries, but they were like East Village galleries. So I suppose it would be like, if you look at it now, it would be kind of like Lower East Side versus, say, Chelsea as a kind of, you know. So, but I think a lot of it, of course, has to do with like New York kind of topology, right? Like, I mean, East Village was cheap, you know. The spaces were small and they're still small
yeah.
and cheap, you know, and whereas like Soho, you could get a bigger loft or whatever. So it's all about like, yeah, people like just kind of being able to afford it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, and we could all live in the city.
Yeah.
And pay our like $200.
But what's, yeah, exactly. No, I remember reading something, there was, maybe it was your, maybe it's in the profile on you, the $290 a month rent or something like that for a 3-bedroom apartment. Yeah.
Well, not 3-bedroom. It was like we were 3 people sharing an apartment. It's like a 3-room space. You know, it's not a small place.
It's
but
a beautiful
it's, yeah.
place.
It's actually weirdly right, about right.
Yeah.
But anyway, yeah, so, you know, it's, and yeah, and that was like back then, I mean, to pay $290 in the East Village on 7th Street between B and C. Was probably too much.
Right.
You know,
right,
like
right,
my
right.
neighbors were probably paying $90, you know.
Wow.
Yeah.
Right, right, right. But it's interesting. I mean, I've been thinking a lot about this conversation and you know, one of the things and one of the reasons I asked is that there's a smallness to everything that you're describing, or it feels like there's a localness to that moment
mm-hmm.
In the 90s, and that part of the mythology, if you want to call it that, or the origin story of many artists from that period is around a smallness, a guerrilla style, whether it's Jason Rhodes or, you know, showing out of the back of a truck or your show in the Chelsea Hotel, Elizabeth, like there's all these mythologies around that. And it seems to me that that's not available to artists, or doesn't feel as available to artists now, younger artists. And I wonder if you guys
It certainly could be.
Yeah.
I mean, you could just go do anything anywhere if you wanted to. Especially right now with all this empty office space, I was thinking there might be another wave of performance in Midtown, you know, kind of thing.
Yeah. I mean, it's you know, again, like, you see how people have to kind of find their spaces. And of course, it starts to go like Bushwick or whatever, you know, Red Ridgewood or whatever, you know, it starts to go, you know, the periphery starts to be bigger in that sense.
Right.
Because, of course, I mean,
but
I mean, I kind of say, well, you know, but then you could go to, you know, Detroit, you know,
right,
or Kansas City or.
But all I mean is, I'll just say that that doesn't seem to be what's actually happening, right? Though that's possible in theory, it seems like there's a movement, younger artists, even younger and younger, are making these moves into much more visible spaces, whether they're big galleries, you know, like there's a premium on making that kind of a career move.
I think there's a different, well, I couldn't speak for anybody, but I do think it was coming out of, not just because we didn't have money, but it really was a point of view of how one wanted to move around in the world and bring our art into the world, you know, and a kind of economy about what you needed, which wasn't much, actually, to to land, you know, and put your voice out there. I think I noticed when I was last teaching, there's just a lot of different expectations about the goal.
Yeah.
You know.
What would you say more about that? Like, what did you perceive the goal?
Well, I can't really speak for anybody, but from my experience with some students, I felt like they, success was not so much about the inside of their relationship with the work as much as all the outside stuff. It's very cliche, and in a way I would say that, but I don't know. I just think it's all possible still.
No, I guess that's what's interesting is that it was possible then, it's still possible now, but then it was really happening. Like, that seemed to be the foundations were being sown for, you know.
And we looked at, of course, the people from the 50s and the 60s in that way too, right? That they were somehow managing to do things that, you know, didn't seem like, I mean, it's completely a whole way of being outside of the
space
kind of structure, right? And but I think, of course, like, I must say that I mean, art has a kind of different economy, you know, and I mean it's certainly, I mean, even this idea of NFTs, you know, like the idea that more people would be engaged into it has, I think, to do with also the idea that there's economy.
There's a financialization.
It. Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. You know?
So I think, and so I would say that for me, I think, I mean, we didn't think about it that way. I still don't think about it that way, right? I still don't think, oh, I'm gonna, I mean, I don't think about like what happens financially with the work ever, why am I doing it for any reason? It has more to do with some other reason,
right?
But of course, I think at the same time, then, you know, everything is also like tripled, you know, like, I mean, students who goes to school today are, you know, having to pay for a lot to, you know, to go to grad school, to go to art school, you know, I mean, everything seems exponentially, like, you know.
So they have to become an art star right away to get out of
then you end up having, you know, then you end up having to, you have to think about finances and things like that.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, so it's a question. It's a big question. You know, I mean, and you've taught, like, in Germany, so it's a little bit different, of course, in other places, right? I mean, it's different in Thailand.
Yeah, I found in Germany everybody was very focused. I mean, some great students, of course, but something definitely from the school is being dangled out there about career.
Uh-huh.
Definitely.
Yeah, and that's it. That word, career.
Career. Yeah.
You know. Yeah.
Like
your favorite word, Rick.
And you know, like, you guys talking about career. Well, you know, like, we never
get a gallery?
Yeah, but it's not. It's just.
But of course, you want to have a future, and you want to be able to eat and
Exactly.
So nothing wrong with that. I mean, I don't have any problem with, you know, work being valuable and all that, of course, but more what you need to do to make the work or get it out there or the means to do it.
Yeah, and then, you know, and then on the other hand, of course, you also then, the more you do, the more you kind of then have to find ways to do it also, yeah, right? Yeah.
Wait, what do you mean by that?
I mean, like, I realized
I
was like, earlier.
Okay, I thought I understood, but I don't think.
Well, like early on, I say this to my students, like, I don't have a studio, for example.
Right.
You know, I work with a lot of people, but I don't have a place. I don't have to pay rent for a space and whatever it is that I do, I don't have to store it. I mean, you know, I do have some things I have to keep and things like that, but in a way I've kind of found a system where I don't have to have a lot to exist in that sense. Right. So, but once you start and then as a student, once you make all these works just for school,
you got to put them somewhere.
Yeah. You're going to have to keep them somewhere.
I always had a feeling about that when I was in school, about living, like using it, the limitation as a positive thing.
Right.
And that's a big reason why I was making small pictures, because I always felt like I could just put that work in a suitcase and take it with me wherever, you know, and it would be easier for people to take care of it.
Mm.
And it could kind of go in a stealthy way out into the world.
Right. Yeah, and your early works were basically recycled things.
Oh, right? Yeah, I was working on windows that I found on
the glass,
the street, and all kinds of stuff like that. I like those limitations because there's so many choices to make anyway. So you can get a lot out of not much.
Yeah.
I always find that really exciting.
I kind of feel I have to ask you, Rirkrit, just because you've basically, I mean, you've been teaching since, what, the...
Last century.
Yeah, exactly. No, but I mean, maybe 30 years or something like that, or I don't know.
Yeah, 25.
About 25 years. So, and have you noticed some of what we're talking about among the students? I mean, you, Elizabeth, sort of said that you had noticed something, this career sensibility, if you want to call it that, but that mixed in, there's still amazing students who are, of course, there always will be.
And of course, there's a good way of thinking about the career as well. Like, ambition is not a bad thing, that drive, because that's gets your work out there. But I think what you're talking about, Rirkrit, is
no. I mean, I different. Think it's just like I try to instill a sense of like no compromise. In the sense, like, you know, to kind of, if you're gonna do something, do it all the way, which can mean a lot of commitment when you don't have, you know, financial structure, right?
Yeah.
But on the other hand, I mean, that commitment maybe is also like about like taking your time doing things or like, you know, because you want to do it right or you want to get that idea to the right place. So, so I like to try to say to them, you know, take your time, you know.
Don't rush.
Yeah. You know, and I think within that time structure, of course, you have to think and do things, but, you know, it's not like you're going to make the masterpiece like for your, you know, show at the end of the school year.
Right.
You'd probably be better down the line to kind of come up with something like that has a bigger impact. But, you know, it's about, I mean, for me, of course, it's always been about like finding yourself or finding your place.
Yeah.
You know, the self and the place where one could be comfortable and thinking and free in some sense.
Yeah.
Right? So, yeah, it's very hard to, I mean, I mean, I'm teaching and I keep saying that, of course, I'm there to do the opposite of teaching because I think, I mean, you know, in a way, like, because you can't really teach
how to be
an artist, you know.
But you can model it in some way, right? Like you can show a way of being in the world, which is what you say is more in a pursuit of freedom than being a participant in a, I don't know, financial economy or the things that actually most people do most of the time, which are absolutely fine, but are not necessarily what it means to be an artist, right?
Yeah.
It's like, and it feels like when I've seen you with your students, I mean, the last time I saw you, you showed up at a dinner that was intended for you with four students in tow. And it felt clear that you were modeling a non, it wasn't about how to do things the right way, right? It was sort of like how to be in a situation in an authentic way or in a genuine way, you know?
Yeah.
There is no right way.
Yeah.
I think there is a lot you can teach actually to students, like a combination of teaching and also really being an agent of saying it's okay to be yourself and to do what you want. And there's so much anxiety about, you know, say even people painting or things like that. But I think there's a lot of teaching one can do about, you know, you're using your body to make art. You need to take care of it.
Mm.
You know, stuff like that, very basic.
Mm.
You know, or use good tools or purposely use really bad tools. But know what you're using, because that's going to make such a big difference on the marks you make on the, you know, because it's so unfashionable to actually teach anything in these really great schools. People often don't even understand the mediums they're using. On a very basic level, you can really help people out in a teaching environment.
Yeah.
Because it's like, oh, new.
I mean, I even feel the function inserting yourself between the students and whatever these structures are that are exerting pressure, you know, whether they're market forces or they're critical forces or there's some kind of, they seem a lot of them to have to do with speed and technology.
Yeah. Well, and it's all like, I mean, it's all relative. Everyone has a different trajectory and reason for being, you know, so it's not like something, you know, but I think, that idea of, I mean, I always talk more about mapping and, you know, like just like, you know, like be able to show the path or like the idea that there are paths and one is able to choose, you know.
It's interesting that you brought up NFTs because there's a line that I liked, Elizabeth, that you said at the end of, I mean, it's very funny that both of you have had these very overlapping lives in some way, and then you both get New Yorker profiles by the same writer. It's like very kind of eccentric, like a couple of years apart. But anyway, at the end of your Calvin Tompkins profile, Elizabeth, you say, you're talking about Proust, and you say, you know, it's important that that artwork expresses what it is to be human, and part of being human is that time passes, right? That time passing is just part of the human experience. And it feels to me that there's a lot less room in the artist world in which we live now for time to simply be allowed to pass, quote unquote, unproductively, whatever that means. I mean, again, being an artist, nothing is unproductive theoretically, right?
Yeah.
I mean, my class is about like not doing anything.
Yeah.
Right? But it's, again, it's not about not doing anything. It's about like rethinking what it is that one does, you know? And I mean, I see the role of the artist in society as like the, you know, counterposition from the rest of the other positions, right? Which is to say, I'm going to not do when everyone's doing, you know? And I think that's just, I mean, maybe like I would say, and this is a discussion I have with my peers, is like, we have doubts about everything, you know? And from that position, we can like, then place ourselves, you know, in terms of like how we think, why things are, right?
Meaning almost like you're skeptics.
Yes.
Highly skeptical, yeah.
I mean, yeah, but it's not like a kind of negative thing. It's about like, you know, looking at the corner of things rather than the middle of things, you know? It's not as if we don't take position, you know? But at the same time, but when we're in a position to be able to do that, I mean, you know.
Well, I think it's also a discipline of being free, you know, when you're an artist. And that's something I think I wake up and sort of brush against every day to remember that's my job.
It's to be free. Yeah.
In a way, and to make my mind free.
Wow.
So this stuff can happen. Yeah. Well, when you get hung up on being productive in a literal way, I mean, your hands got to be in there, you're doing, but you have to like trust in the opening up of yourself in a much different way than any of that world is about, and, you know, really make yourself free.
Mm.
And I say things like, you know, to be free, you don't, you know, you have to just understand that there are things. I mean, so I say, if you think like as an artist, you are able to do anything.
Mm.
And which also means like that you don't always have to make art.
Sure.
You can make many other things. You could support yourself doing a lot of different things. And then art would be the other thing that you do, which is, you know, so there are like different ways of surviving.
Yeah.
That I think as an artist, one should be able to like think about how to like find your way around things.
Right. Not hold on too tight to one thing.
Yeah. And I would say for me, and that, I mean, you know, I would say maybe that's a place where you can become more free because you're not dependent just on like the idea of having to make art.
Right.
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 Most people don't agree with that because they think, wow, one has to be free to make art. But I'm kind of saying you're more free if you don't have to, you know.
Right. If your financial pressure is dealt with through some other thing that allows you to be genuinely free in your creative production, theoretically.
Yeah. Or on the other hand, also like all the other things you do is informing your art.
Yeah.
Always. The worst job in the world is informing like everything you do, you know. Mm. So I tend to, and then, you know, and I can say, well, you know, I have a job. I'm teaching, you know. It's not like I'm not working, you know, like I am like free to roam around. But yeah, to get to that position, I've done a lot of other jobs, you know, and it's, and I do say, you know, and I'm ready to go and do other jobs if I don't have this job, you know?
Right.
So, but one has to kind of, you know, understand that one's capable of doing that and that it's not like, you just gotta have to use it.
Yeah, I mean, it was also, there's fear involved in not, you know, there's a lack of fear once you accept that if this job gets taken away, if this career goes away, it's okay because I'm the agent of this thing to begin with. And if I have to turn my mind and do something else, that will be okay, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But getting people there, that seems to be like one of the things that an arts educator could really do in some way is instill that or remove some of that fear in some way, you know, which is certainly what the world wants you to feel, because I think the normal world, as it were, doesn't want people to be free. It wants you to be committing to something, tracked into something, you know.
But I think it's the thing that people admire the most in other people, why they love actors and artists and writers. They imagine that we're all very free.
Yes.
And, you know, outliving our lives for people who aren't free, sort of thing.
But then even all those people are also not that free.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's a discipline, yeah. I feel like.
I liked what you were saying, that there's a work involved in maintaining that freedom.
It's a practice.
Yeah.
I think there's a constant learning about it within yourself, what it means.
And I also would like to say that, you know, we are talking here, sitting in New York City, even like, you know, we're sitting in a sphere that is like there are other spheres outside and there are people surviving and making art outside of this sphere that we don't even know, or, you know, we're, you know, slowly maybe find out. But no, I mean, I'm, you know, I know young artists in Thailand that nobody's ever seen, and they're like, and they don't have a museum, they don't have a gallery.
Right.
But they continue to make art. And they continue to do other things, but, you know, they continue to make art. And if, you know, young artists or even old artists in Thailand could do that,
right,
and continue to be artists, I mean, you know, I don't see why you can't do that in the middle of New York, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So that's the thing, is we have to remember that this is just one place,
mm-hmm,
with one structure and system, and that this is what our perspective is narrowly here now. But, you know, there are people out there that are continuing to do that, you know.
When we, to go back to the beginning of the story, when we were first showing, and Rirkrit maybe was showing a couple years before me, there wasn't that many eyes on the art world in that way. It wasn't cool, like,
right,
or anything like that. So maybe one didn't have the expectation that there was this one kind of model of success like there is in New York City, say, now.
Mm-hmm.
All that stuff was all to come. And it's funny to think that we might have been a part of it in our, like, actually doing something that was sort of very different.
That's kind of why I began that with that conversation about the 90s, because it's sort of like unbeknownst in a way to either of you, you find yourself, you are still at the center in some way of these now structures that have formed around what each of you was doing in a very, in a much smaller, you know, more casual way. And I wonder if that's something that you ever think about.
I'm always really surprised when I remember, like, I'm very grateful that I get to do what I do. I really am. But it's a bit of a surprise that, that I do get to do it. Because it's not the most likely thing in a way. And it certainly wasn't at the time I started to show.
Right.
So I think I forget about it a lot, actually.
Do you mean the general thing of being an artist, or specifically the kind of art that you make?
I mean, I'm not being a narcissist here. I do think that it was particularly not right. You know, it wasn't, but I felt like it was really missing and that it was very right. But around me was not a world that was saying this was what we want or anything like that. And it's still not a world that is saying we want feminine, you know, paintings. I guess it does.
Yeah, no, it clearly does.
Luckily, you know, I'm very grateful I get to do what I do. But I can't tell you.
What drew you guys to each other's work? You know, because I've been thinking a lot today about the similarities. There's a kind of openness to what the world presents, whether that's the images that the world is feeding in that you are picking up on, or just having people be in the work and activate the work.
Are you raising your hand?
I am. Well, I think both of our work is very accessible on the surface, you know, as a way of entering it. I know with Rirkrit, often people would think, oh, this sweet guy cooking, so sweet. I mean, he is very sweet, but it was also a way of gathering people together. And then from there, what would happen? So much could happen. It's not necessarily sweet.
Right, right.
You know, and I think my work also, people can look at it and know what other humans are. And there's a way into it, you know, with color and things like that, that you get drawn in. Gavin used to always say about us, well, they're populists. That's what they are.
Yeah.
Like very for the people.
And he was such an important connection point for you both, right, Gavin Brown? I mean, his name has come up such
and
a legendary.
And he still is again. Yes.
Yeah, we should have him here.
Yeah, exactly.
I know.
I wonder what he would say.
He'd have a lot to say because he's so much a part of
that story.
The story. Yeah.
But I think it's like, again, I was starting with this idea of the energy, you know, like, I mean, and the spirit, you know, I mean, and that's how I usually approach art and artists anyway, you know, I approach the person, you know, and from that, then I, you know, go out from there. Yeah. But
it felt important to me, your work, when I first met you. I mean, it still does, but I felt like this is necessary.
Yeah, like it was making, I like what you said, it's making a space for things to happen, and there's an accessibility, but then what happens in that space is unpredictable in the best sense of the word.
Yeah, sometimes it could be really scary.
Oh, but, and I think Elizabeth is doing that.
Yes.
I mean, she's making what's necessary for her, you know,
yeah.
And that's where also all the energy comes from.
Yeah. That's very interesting that at root, you're saying it's sort of like identifying the thing that each person needs to make for themselves, as opposed to the thing that maybe they think would plug a hole somewhere, you know what I mean? Like, or be relevant or whatever it is.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like the feeling I really need this.
Yeah.
Right.
To survive.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I need to see this or experience this.
And I mean, again, we can cut this out or not talk about it, but the different accounts of your meeting and subsequent elopement or very rapid marriage, there's a kind of green card version of the story, as it were. But underneath that, it also feels like there's a deep connection. You know, it wasn't like...
Just like destiny.
Destiny, yeah.
No, because it's just like we, you know, we met and then we were in this room and then, you know, yeah, I don't know.
Rirkrit said, like, well, I was like, how are you? And Rirkrit said, I need to get married. And I said, I'll marry you.
Exactly.
And I totally meant it. Yeah, and yeah. We were together like every day from that moment.
Yeah.
That's amazing. And you and your friendship has just remained. It seems like it's something that's been a huge part of your lives.
Yes, I mean yeah. We're our family.
Yeah,
not even
Christ. No.
We're you know, it's a family relationship.
Yeah,
it's,
and also because kinship. Of Gavin, actually, mm-hmm. I think you yeah, because the gallery feeling also is such a family.
Yeah.
Too, but yeah. Yes.
And did you, have you guys been, like, has there been cross-communication in your practices? Like, is there conversation about what you're working on or what you're working on? Is that part of the regular dialogue or?
No.
No?
We talk about taxes.
Taxes, yeah.
That's our latest.
Really?
No, but I think that's.
The young artists listening to this will love to hear
That's the joke. Bankers talk about art and artists talk about taxes.
No, but I think that is true with, I mean, with most friends, we don't really talk about the work. Like,
yeah.
You know, we talk about the life.
Yeah,
we talk about what we're thinking, what we're eating, what we're reading.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that informs the work,
of course, you know.
And I mean, those are the kinds of things which make me understand what Elizabeth is thinking about and doing and, you know,
yeah.
What she's looking at. And yeah.
Yeah, it's like the pot everything's mixing in.
Yeah. Yeah.
And is, you know, it's kind of curious to ask just because it feels like it must play a role, but it's such a weird time right now that we're in. And
it's not weird to ask.
No, it's almost like one has to ask. I'm just curious how in each of your lives you're processing that or, you know, if everything that happens in life plays a role in the way that the art comes out, as it were. How does the tenor of the world, obviously I'm talking about the political situation primarily, but other things too.
I'm looking at a lot more news than I usually do.
Uh-huh.
And also watching all Zelensky's speeches.
Yes.
And reading them.
Yeah.
It's good to see that the measure is so equal of this incredible goodness. I mean, you couldn't make it up. And this very bad, dark energy pouring out at the same time.
No, I mean, I think it's hard to do. I mean, it's hard to think about doing things when you know that there are people dying, right? I mean, there's a war. And so, you know, it's, and I can like see how Elizabeth would deal with it and how I would deal with it.
Right.
And do you notice, is that something that, you know, are the students finding it difficult to make things in this moment?
I think they still, I think that they're like not processing it the same way I do. Partly because, you know, I think also like the human is changing, right?
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, you know, that information or the process of how one takes information in and all those things, how one perceives information is different.
You know?
Like, I take it in a, I mean, I can see that what I feel about what I'm seeing and hearing and all that, I think about it in a different way than I think what my student would, you know. It's hard to say. I think it's just kind of, I mean, the COVID thing, of course, is a very big, you know, kind of impact on everyone. And I think everyone is still trying to, like, kind of find their way out of that, right?
Would you say a little more? Like, when you say, can you identify some of what you think that impact has been?
Well, I mean, I think a lot of people felt like kind of, well, one thing, interestingly, is the fact of, like, the kind of, like, distance, you know, so everyone speaks about like, oh, how great it is to suddenly be sitting around the table together, right? Or to see each other in person rather than through like a screen, you know, though of course, they already living through the screen anyway, you know, in a certain way. So, and I think, yeah, I think people are still trying to process how to, like, kind of come to terms with, like, the distance.
Yeah.
You know.
That's very different from when we started showing.
Yeah.
I mean, we didn't have this kind of situation, but we also didn't have phones.
Yeah.
So our sense of community was so actual.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, there's great aspects of the phone, too. I'm not just dissing the phone, but the community was so rich, nothing to do with money. You know, just like gave you that support
I was gonna ask about that because the digitalization that's happened so rapidly, especially in the last 2 years, it's very complicated, you know, and certain things translate really well and certain things, like an experiential piece by you, don't translate at all, you know. It's sort of like it creates this, I mean, I was even thinking on my way over that probably certain paintings that you make actually translate very well on a screen. You know what I mean? Like, they look vivid. People can respond to them. Some images do that and some images don't, right? Or some practices don't. And that's this other layer that I've been noticing as we all work through the world of experiences, digital and physical, that some things work really well digitally and some things really don't. And it's...
And when you see them in real life, they can have a very different energy to them than you think.
But it's also like people may not think they even need to see it in real life, you know?
Yeah.
That's the whole other thing. But I think those are all like kind of really good problems.
Yeah.
At least for artists to deal with.
Right.
You know, those are problems for artists to think and deal and, yeah, you know, how, what is it that, what, how do you still, you know, where are we going to go?
Yeah.
You know?
Do you mean literally, where are we going to go?
I mean, you know, with all those...
Where's this going?
Yeah, you know, where is it going? And I mean, and on the other hand, I feel like, of course, as artists, maybe there is a kind of counter, you know, movement, right? Mm. You know?
I would agree.
I mean, in the last years, a lot of... I mean, all the artists that I deal with at school, you know, everyone's making ceramics.
Yeah.
And there's a reason for that, right? I mean, why is, you know, why are filmmakers making ceramics or, you know, like, you know, so everyone is having to kind of put their hand on something.
Materiality. You know?
And I think that is some kind of a, yeah, that's a kind of sign, right? Of,
right.
Like, so I would think like at some point there would be, you know, certain focus, you know, because in the end, we still need those instincts.
Yeah.
And have them.
Yeah.
No, I feel that too. I feel that there's going to be, it's almost like the heightened exposure to the screens in the last 2 years just made certain things that were hidden very clear, like these hierarchies about what works digitally and what doesn't, which is something that we didn't realize that, you know, what's happening on Instagram has a lot to do with what translates digitally and what doesn't. It's not about the object itself. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's...
I just found out why on like a Netflix series, why all the clothing is so brightly colored. It looks good on a tiny
looks good
screen.
On a small screen.
I just thought, because I was like, why are my teenage nieces always wanting these rainbow striped? I mean, they're great, but you know, where are they getting that from?
No, but the feedback loop between screen and real life, it's almost like that became clear.
Mm-hmm.
And as we now return to in-person experiences, it's like, you don't want, when you go to a party, you don't want to see everyone wearing a bright neon dress. You know what I mean? It's like, that's not a sign of what you actually want. Neither do you want to be in a room with only paintings that are sort of like, have extreme contrast. You know what I mean? That's because contrast is one of the things that seems to get people's attention on the screen, right?
But it's even like, you don't even know if it's true, right? Because you could just... you know, put the filter or you could just...
That's right.
So, you know, there is no real surface even, right?
Right,
so
right.
That's the thing. And then, and of course, like, if you are not from a time where you question, I mean, that's why I think, like, this idea of doubt is like,
so
you know, if you don't question all these things, then you believe in that reality, you know? And I think that's an interesting area to think and work on.
Thank you guys so much.
Thank you so much.
Oh my God, thank you guys. All right. It was so,
it's really
so
nice to talk with you.
Yeah, really nice to talk with you both. I felt very energized by it, actually.
Good.
Good. Let's go get them.
Dialogues is produced by David Zwirner. You can find out more about the artists on this series by going to davidzwirner.com/dialogues. And if you liked what you heard, please rate and review us on Apple Podcasts or wherever you listen. It really does help other people discover the show. I'm Lucas Zwirner. Thanks so much for listening, and I hope you join us again next time.